Hi everyone, it's David here from Cruise Show UK. Welcome back to my channel. I'm preparing for my third cruise of 2021 and in 11 days time I'll be heading back off to Southampton to join P&O's flagship Britannia. This will be my 36th cruise, so join me as I prepare for that little trip and I kind of reminisce a little bit about my last time on the Britannia, which was a fantastic transatlantic crossing all the way to the Caribbean. I returned from my last cruise on the Viking Venus just 2 weeks ago, and it reminded me that one of the things I really love about cruising is all the food. I'll put a link to that video in the description below, so you should give it a watch afterwards. For those of you that booked a cruise on the Britannia, one of the things you're really going to like is all the food on board. We find it to be very, very good. There's plenty of choice. And one of my favourite things is the afternoon tea. And you can have the afternoon tea in the Horizon Buffet, which is really, really good. Or if you want an extra special treat, you can upgrade to a celebrity chef afternoon tea. And it's by Eric Lanlard. And it's served in the Epicurean restaurant, which is really fancy. And it's just a beautiful experience. So my last trip on the Britannia was back in October 2018, when everything pandemic related was so far out of my mind. We traveled from Southampton all the way across to Barbados. And it really was one of the best cruises that I've been on. Everything was just perfect. It was our first time on P&O, so you had that new cruise line feeling. Everything's new. P&O really know their market well, and everything on board their ships is geared towards the Brits. So the entertainment, the drinks, they have our favorite beers, the meals in the main restaurant. It's all geared towards the Brits, so they'll have our favourite foods. We'll have a curry, roast dinners, shepherd's pie, all that sort of thing. And obviously tea as well. They have all the British teas on board, absolute importance. Don't waste my time with that Lipton tea. So anyway, it's all geared towards the Brits, and it really works well, and it really surprised me. I wasn't expecting it to be that good for whatever reason, I don't know. I love my time on the Britannia. It was a really great cruise. So I'm really looking forward to going back on board for the 3 nights. Super excited. Britannia normally caters for over 3,500 passengers. But for these first few cruises that start up, it's going to be limited to 1,000 passengers, and that's due to restrictions put in place by the UK government. So I'm really looking forward to that. There's going to be plenty of space on board the ship for everybody. On our last cruise, when it was operating at normal capacity, it never really felt overly crowded. There were a few busy periods in the buffet, but that's normal. But generally the ship was everyone was spread out nicely. There's plenty of room on board to sit and relax, lots and lots of deck space, so that's another thing that I love about the Britannia. It never really feels overly crowded. Right, okay, so preparing for this cruise. So before I go on any cruise, I like to keep a wallet like this, a plastic wallet with all the documents that I'm going to need. It's all in one place, so I highly recommend you getting one of these. You can buy them on Amazon or at your local supermarket. And basically, everything you need for the cruise is in one place. So first thing, passport. Even if you're going on one of these UK cruises, you have to take your passport. On my first cruise on the MSC Virtuosa, I heard of a couple that turned up without their passports, and they thought that just because they were going on this UK cruise, they didn't need it. So don't make the same mistake. If you're going on the UK staycation cruises, you have to take your passport. So don't forget that. Second thing, car parking. So I have booked with CPS car parking. They do all the car parking for P&O Cruises, and it's so easy. So I highly recommend it, that you park your car. It's right alongside the ship. It's super easy and convenient. For this small trip, it cost me £50, which is fine. In the past, we have used the car parking at the Asda supermarket. It's called Marslands. And for a longer trip, you might want to consider it. For a 14-night trip, CPS would charge £162. And Marslands would be £112. We've also taken the train to Southampton before, which is quite a good option. You don't have to worry about car parking then, and you can get some really good deals with the train. And the train station is quite nearby to the port. You will need to get a taxi to the port. We are still in COVID times, and P&O have set up a drive-through testing centre. Everyone needs to be vaccinated against COVID, and you also have to have a negative PCR test before you get on the ship. So they've set up this drive-through test center. You go to that drive-through test center, take your test, wait in your car. They then send you a text message, and as long as that comes back clear, you're good to go. Next is insurance. You have to make sure that your insurance is valid and covers you for COVID and cruise. Make sure you check, because we normally have annual travel insurance through our bank. On further inspection, it didn't cover us from COVID. So we have booked with a company called StaySure, and it was really, really cheap. If you just want a single trip, it would have cost us £9.75, which is a really good deal. It covers you for COVID, and it covers you for medical repatriation from the ship if need be, and obviously cruise as well. When you print your document off, it has to be visible that it covers you for COVID and cruise. Otherwise, it just causes a big delay at the port. They have to phone your insurance just to make sure. So yeah, we use StaySure for our insurance. I'll put a link below if you want to check them out. A really good pricing. As I said, for us, for a single trip, it was £9.75. Or we went for the annual, which was £36, which is pretty good. Yeah, sorted. So now moving on to packing. Now, I really like packing. Well, actually, no, I don't really like packing. I like it because you know that you're going on holiday. But my two dogs, my two golden retrievers, they hate packing. They hate it. Their ears drop when they see those suitcases coming down from the loft, because they know they're going away somewhere. Okay, so here's some essential tips for what I always pack when going on a cruise. Tea bags. So the Brits are all going to say yes. Oh, great idea. Americans, you might find it a bit weird, but it's very important to us Brits. And trust me, there is nothing worse than racking up to the drink station and being met with just Lipton tea. Moving on from tea bags, because I'm very lucky to go on cruises quite often, I always have a vanity set ready in my suitcase, just full of essential bits and bobs. So the first one here is I always find quite handy, is a lanyard for your cruise card. And you can go to the purser's desk and ask them to punch a hole in it, and then you just pop it on there and you're sorted. Although, having said that, a lot of the cruise lines now are moving away from the key cards and moving to wearable devices. Princess, they've got their medallion, and I expect more and more cruise lines to be following that route. These are quite handy, especially if you're going on an older ship. This is an American one, but it's basically a set of USB sockets Really handy. On the newer ships, you'll find USB sockets everywhere, but on the older ships, you'll struggle to find the USB. So, and all of our devices, they're all USB these days, so this can be really handy. Then these are a good option, anti-back wipes, especially if you're going on a plane. We used to use those before the pandemic anyway, so they're good to have. You can get them on Amazon again. Motion sickness patches, good to have. I don't really get seasick, but my partner does. So motion sickness patches, they're really good. You pop them in on the back of your ear. Seasickness bands that you wear on your wrists. You might not think that, well, I used to think they were just a gimmick, but they actually do work, so they're worth giving them a go. Just a few little tips that I always take with me when I go on a cruise, so you might find it useful. If you did like this video, please give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing. It will really help me out to really get the channel going. Also, just before I go, I wanted to give a shout out to Gary Benbridge, Tips for Travelers. If you are not a subscriber of his, but you like cruising and travel or river cruises, then definitely search for Gary. He does some fantastic videos. He's so knowledgeable. Also, take a look at all these cruises that I've got booked for the rest of this year. It's going to be a very busy summer. I'm very lucky. I can't wait to be bringing you all that excellent content from their ship tours, cabin tours, the whole lot. So really excited. And leave me a comment and let me know what you're looking forward to the most on your first cruise back when you eventually take your next cruise. Okay, I think that's it. Till next time, I will see you up on deck.